I imagine what can be. I imagine that we will not build a building big enough to house what God is going to do. I imagine masses and masses and masses of people. I imagine 1,000 people on a Sunday coming to Jesus Christ in one service. Come on in Pretoria. I imagine God can do great things. I imagine God can do great things in your life. Oh, come on, shout amen. If you believe it tonight, in the name of Jesus, imagine. Imagine.
Hi there, and welcome to Discover Life.
Today, Pastor Art will be continuing his encouraging message titled, Imagine the Good. May you be blessed by this message.
The law of the lid requires a large jar with a lid. The fleas are then placed inside the jar, and the lid is then sealed. They are left undisturbed for 3 days. Then, when the jar is opened, the fleas will not jump out. In fact, the fleas will never jump higher than the level set by the lid. The behavior is now set for the rest of their lives. And when the fleas reproduce, their offspring will automatically follow.
Genesis 11 verse 1, the Bible says, "Now the whole earth had one language and one speech. It came to pass as they journeyed from the east, and they found a plain in the land of Shinar, that they dwelled there. Then they said to one another, 'Come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly.' They had brick and stone, and they had asphalt for mortar. And they said, 'Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth.' But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, 'Indeed, listen now, the people are one, and they all have one language. And this which they begin to imagine to do, now nothing they propose, or the word propose means nothing they imagine to do will be withheld from them.' Then Isaiah chapter 29, verse 7, the Bible says, 'Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind or whose imagination is stayed on thee.'" Say with me tonight, imagination. No, don't whisper it. You need to talk when you come to this church, okay? Christianity is called the great confession, not the great frown. Amen. Not the great "I dare you bless me" attitude, but receive with meekness the engrafted word of God, which is able to save your soul. So say it again tonight, say imagination. So your imagination can be used either as a destructive instrument in your life or as a positive instrument. We see the story in Genesis 11 of the Babylonians who used their imagination to build a tower unto the heavens. They imagined a wicked plan, and they united together, seeing the future, not that God had for them, but the future they planned. Well, God calls us as Christians to imagine a better future. In Jeremiah 29, verse 11, God says, "I know the thoughts I think toward you, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope." 1 Corinthians 2 verse 9 and 10, "Eye has not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those who love him, but God has revealed them to us by his Spirit." So obviously the key is to see the things that God wants us to see, to imagine the good and not the bad. Imagine the best case scenario. Take the glasses off. Hallelujah. Don't look at your world through the negative paradigms and the pain of yesterday and the frustration of your setbacks. So many people have their vision clouded, do not have a clear imagination of the future. And it's this Jesus who came, who said, "I've come that you may have life and have it more abundantly." Say with me tonight, say abundantly. So we need to get rid of the dark spectacles, get rid of the dark areas in our imagination, and imagine the good. Imagine the future, the way God sees it for you and me. So there are two types of imaginations that control people. Obviously, positive imaginations and negative imaginations. Right pictures or images will stretch you, whilst wrong images, pictures in your mind, will shrink you. Most people are controlled by small pictures because somewhere in life people told them what they cannot do, and they have believed that. So they don't even attempt to do anything for God. They don't attempt any great thing for God because they have a dominant picture in their mind that says, "You're not good enough. You can never do that. You don't have what it takes." And we're going to talk about it tonight because I'm here to tell you, you have everything you need. You have everything that it takes. In Christ, you are complete. If you believe it tonight, say amen and give the Lord a praise. Hallelujah. So obviously, God wants to stretch us. Jesus came to stretch us, not just to give us a get-by life. As a matter of fact, when he discipled these disciples, he was always challenging their ceiling. He was always challenging the status quo. He was not a conformer, but a reformer. He taught his disciples to think differently. Never allowed them to sit, settle, and soak. Never allowed them to cement themselves in the mediocrity and excuses that they might accumulate. He always challenged them to think higher, to go further. We read in the Bible words such as, get out of the boat. 11 sat, one got out of the boat. You never know what's going to happen until you get out of the boat. Changing your focus and your imagination. Come on, nudge your neighbor tonight and say, you are going to get out of the boat in Jesus' name. Janie Jammersikkel family were taught that don't get your hopes up too high, don't think too big, because you cannot expect to go beyond your parents, because your parents never went beyond their grandparents, and the grandparents never went beyond the great-grandparents. So people are born inevitably with limitations and with ceilings. And really, one of the greatest or most difficult things to do is to lift that ceiling, is to see Christ for who he is and to see yourself for who God made you to be. So Jesus comes and he challenges the people all the time, and he says, launch out into the deep. When you start a business, don't just start a little business. Start small, but dream big. Believe God that anything is possible. Let us go over to the other side, is what Jesus says. When there is a storm between them and the other side, he says, let us cross over to the other side. When the disciples came and they said, the multitude are fainting, Jesus says to them, well, what's your problem? Give them something to eat. Be proactive. Think outside of the box. And then finally, to those disciples who grew up in Israel, and if you've ever been in Israel and Nazareth where Jesus grew up, it is a little place not much bigger than this church building we're sitting in tonight. And there Jesus imagined the whole world to be saved. And his final instruction to the church, to those 12 disciples, are go into all the world and make disciples of every creature. So he teaches them the only limitation is what you place upon your own mind. It's what you believe that you will achieve in life. Not what your parents say, not what your grandparents did. It's what you believe. Not what the news reporter says. It's what you believe. So we see in the interaction with Jesus and the disciples, he was very intentional to stretch their mindset, to change their mindset, to get them out from under a ceiling. Common fishermen, and he gives them a worldwide vision. Because when he comes into your boat, everything changes. The ceiling lifts and the unlimited potential of God enters your life. The greater one comes and moves on the inside of you, then you can live with the attitude and the mindset, anything is possible. So family, we must imagine the good. We must imagine the future that God has in mind for us. Imagine the good and not the bad. It takes more energy to imagine the bad, but you might as well imagine the good. Free State Curry Cup. Come now, Francois, say amen. Hallelujah. Imagine the worst case scenario, not the worst. Imagine a promotion, not a retrenchment. Imagine a phone call of blessing, not a phone call of disaster. Imagine a great future and not a terrible future. Imagine a big tomorrow and not a small tomorrow. Imagine what can be. Imagine who you can be. Imagine what you can accomplish. Dream the impossible dream. It costs nothing to dream, but it costs everything not to dream. Because when you dream, you release yourself into the future. When you don't dream, you'll never enter the future. You'll never enter the potential that God has for you. So when you talk to people, especially in Christian spiritual circles, they will say, but Pastor, imagination is a carnal thing. Really? We all imagine all the time, good things and bad things. As you sit there today, you are thinking in pictures. If I say dog, you don't think D-O-D-G. You think black, 43 kilogram, pit bull terrier. Rocco is his name. That's my dog. Always happy to see me. When you think house, what is the picture that comes? Because we've all grown up in an environment, and whether we like to know it or not, a lid has been placed upon us by our culture, by our traditions, by our religion, by our educators, by winning and losing in life, we allow ceilings to be placed upon us. And when we see it again, we are bouncing in this jar according to the ceiling. And then Jesus comes and he removes the ceiling and he takes you in a new world. And he says, you are a brand new creature created in Christ Jesus. You have unlimited potential on the inside of you. But then so many, although they are redeemed, oh come on, and washed by the blood of Jesus Christ, they are still just bouncing this high. Or they're shuffling along in life. Well, God says you can run. God says you can be anything you want to be if that's my plan for your life. God says nothing is impossible. So obviously we have to get rid of this invisible ceiling that is limiting our imagination. Our imagination being this amazing gift that God gave us. Really, the problem is not with imagination. The problem is to have our imagination under the influence of the Holy Spirit, to think sanctified, God-ordained, God-controlled, and God thoughts in our minds, to think what God thinks. Because everything starts with a thought. Every thought that we meditate on becomes a picture. Every picture that we allow in our mind becomes an imagination. And these very imaginations is what control us. You look at an ad about a holiday, a distant holiday to Hawaii or the Bahamas, and you think, I'll never be able to go. Not me. I believe one day I'm going to sit in Hawaii under a palm tree, and I'm going to have a big coconut filled with something nice, not alcohol, and I'm going to sip my juice with my wife right next to me, and I'm going to sit there and enjoy the moment. I imagine good things. Hallelujah. Imagine the good and not the bad. Imagine what can be and cannot be. Many of our young people that are in our church, we have many thousands of students. You are the first ones that are breaking barriers in your family. You are making history in your generation and in your family. You are starting a lineage of blessing, a lineage of education, a lineage of what is possible. Come on, you are going to get your master's degree. Hallelujah. You are going to get your doctorate in the name of Jesus. People are going to call you doctor one day in the name of Jesus, and that's going to feel good. Hallelujah. Because it's okay. It's okay to dream. It's okay to dream. It's okay to imagine. One day things are going to be better. One day things are going to be different. One day I'm going to have a car. Hallelujah. And I'm going to lower my seat. And I'm going to drive. And people are going to say, I want to be like that man. It's okay to have an imagination. One day I'm going to live in a house like this. One day I'm going to fly on an aeroplane like this. One day I'm going to build a church like this. One day I'm going to sing a song like that. One day I'm going to do this or 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 this for God. I'm not just going to live the same old, same old, same old, same old life, because everybody I hang out have no dreamers or no dreamers and have no imagination. It's amazing how people will imagine disaster rather than blessing. How people can imagine that you don't have a great future rather than imagine you are going to have a great future. Imagine what can be. People came together at the Tower of Babel and they dreamed together. When we dream, it should not be divisive. Dreams should spur one another on. Our imagination do not have to compete. When God blessed Peter, he called for his partners, and God blessed that boat as well. So your imagination can be big enough. One day I'm going to employ 1,000 people. Why not? Imagine South Africa 10 years from now. Not a disastrous South Africa. Many films that are out show 2000, well, we're almost in 2020, but they brought films out like 2020. And what do they imagine? They imagine doom and gloom and disaster. And then they put it through Hollywood into the minds of people. But when Jesus hung on the cross, God imagined good things. Healing, health, deliverance, freedom, blessing, abundance. Imagine the milk and the honey. Imagine the stars. Imagine what you can be. Oh, come on. In the name of Jesus Christ, you have to lift your eyes up and imagine anything is possible. Anything is possible. Everybody thinks in pictures. Little children. Daddy says, I'm going to buy a bicycle. What does the child expect? A brand new bicycle. So when Dad comes there with a bicycle held together by tape, the child says, not the picture I had in my mind. Maybe it's the father's best, but the child still thinks, I'm believing for something. I'm imagining. Come on. Long before I had a car, I imagined I'm going to drive a car. And then I walked past a car one day and I put my hand on that car and I said, one day I'm going to drive a car like this, just like this. I'm careful to put my hand on things because when I do that, they come to me. Oh, you might not like it, but I can imagine myself. You don't want to know what I imagine. I can imagine a lot of things in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 1985, the first time I walked into Raymer Randburg, 5,500 seater auditorium. I was a gopher in the church, but I knew God called me to the ministry. I sat in the back row after standing for 2 hours and I imagined, because it was God's call, it was God's grace upon me, I knew it, I imagined, and I said, one day, I'm going to build a building like this. 1994, I went to Singapore. Lawrence Kong had the biggest church then in Singapore. Second service was a video service. I sat there and the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, one day you will build my church like this through technology. You will preach in one place, people will watch in other places. And I imagine I'm going to preach and people are going to get saved in Pretoria. I'm going to preach and people are going to get saved in London. I'm going to preach and people are going to get saved, oh come on, in Johannesburg. I imagine what can be in Jesus' name. Last week when I flew to the DRC and I saw 50,000 people around a building of only 6,500, you better believe I absorbed it. I imagined, I dreamed, I imagined what can be. I imagine that we will not build a building big enough to house what God is going to do. I imagine masses and masses and masses of people. I imagine 1,000 people on a Sunday coming to Jesus Christ in one service. Come on in Pretoria. I imagine God can do great things. I imagine God can do great things in your life. Oh, come on, shout amen. If you believe it tonight, in the name of Jesus. Imagine! Genesis 12 verse 1, the Bible says, the Lord said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. Notice God always talks about your future and not your past. He says, I will make you a great nation, I will bless you, and your name shall be great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and curse him, the devil, who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. So God brings Abram out of his family's house to break every limitation that's placed upon him by his family. And sometimes families do place limitations upon us, intentionally or unintentionally. Our culture, our tradition. Things people say, things people believe. We just believe certain things. It's inbred. It's passed on from one generation to another generation. In Mark chapter 7, Jesus says, we nullify the power of God's word, holding on to our tradition. So although traditions can be good, traditions in conflict with the Christ nature and the word of God will limit you and restrict you from the life that God has for you. That's why when you come to Jesus, your allegiance is more to him than to your flesh and your blood. Jesus said, those who do hear the word and do the word, they are my mother, my brothers, and my sisters. I will not be limited by my boss of DNA. I will not be limited by my boss of genetics. I am not limited by what my parents say, what my parents did. Well, your dad was an alcoholic. You will turn out an alcoholic. No, you will not. You will turn out a sanctified saint of God. You will turn out the head and not the tail. You will turn out a blessed servant of God. You will turn out a free man of God. Well, all our generations divorced. Well, you are going to break that divorce cycle generation. You will have a blessed marriage. Imagine the future and not the past in the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody shout amen in Jesus' name. So God has to bring Gideon out of his father's house, the wine press, the limiting mindset. God calls him mighty man. And he says, who, me? God says, yes, you. Go in this might of yours and save Israel. Mighty man. But Lord, I'm the least, the weakest. No, you're a mighty man. You're not defined by your circumstances, by your background, by your culture, by people's opinions. You are defined by what God says. The Lord is with you, mighty man. So we must stop imagining the life our family imagined for us and imagine the life that God has for us. So number one, God says to Abraham, get out of your father's house. Number two, God says to Abraham, separate from your cousin, Lot, a limiting relationship. A jealous relationship. Not everybody will go with you to your destination. Genesis 13, verse 13, the Bible says, and the Lord said to Abram, after Lot separated from him, lift your eyes now and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. Remember, Pastor Leon, when we started this church here in Bloemfontein, we stood here, and there were a few hundred people, and we lifted our eyes. We looked to the north. We said to the north, give up. To the south, hold not back. To the east, bring our sons and our daughters. We called people. We call out. We imagine. Long before we build a building, we imagine. Now we're listening, yeah, Bloemfontein South. We are imagining another building, yeah, on this location. So many of you are excited about the north, but the north is an extension of this. Yeah, is going to be a huge revival. And you better get excited and see what's going to happen, yeah, in the south and in Bloemfontein, the whole Bloemfontein. Amen. Well, you sure look excited. Give the Lord a better praise than that. Come on, hallelujah. God says, all the land that you see, I give you. So not everyone can accompany you on your journey. And that's a tough one for people. Because sometimes you want to move on and your friends don't want to move on. You want to serve God and they don't. You want to go to street work and they don't. You want to get involved and they don't. You have decisions to make, to lift your eyes, to not be held back by people because of their vain imaginations, but to pursue what God called you for. So some people choose not to grow at all. Some people choose to remain small. 22 years I've pastored this church, and one of the greatest challenges I face with is the question, how can people be exposed to something bigger and they choose to remain small? It is a choice. Where some people don't want the status quo to change. They want to stay small. God says move on. Have a forward mindset. Have a bigger mindset. So if you pursue your dream, you will have to leave the dream stealers behind. You'll have to move on. You cannot become a camper because of other people. You cannot disqualify yourself through somebody else's offense. You have to imagine your own future. Live with a forward mindset. Look forward. Look to the vision. Lift your eyes and see the land that God has for you. See the milk and the honey. See the stars. Number three, God says to Abraham, come out of your tent and see the stars and count them. Genesis chapter 15, verse 5, he brought him outside and said, look now toward heaven. Hallelujah. God brings him out from under the ceiling, and God says to him, lift your eyes now and see. Because if we only live in our world, that's all we will see. I tell pastors all the time, get out of your environment. And often pastors with the smallest churches will tell you, but I don't have time. I'm sure it's the same with business people. Oftentimes, the smallest thinkers have the least time. I've climbed on airplanes, coached, flown all over this world just to see another world, to imagine what can be. Because I've learned you grow by the places you go, the books you read, the people you need. I don't want to hang out with small people. And by small people, I mean people who think just like me. I want to hang out with people who think bigger than me, better than me. Amen. People who will stretch me, people who will challenge me, people who have climbed the mountain I still am thinking about climbing. And this is exactly what God says to Abraham. Get out of your tank. Get out from under the ceiling. Get out from under the limitations you are placing upon yourself. And lift your eyes and see the stars. See what is possible. Get out of your father's house. Get out of the wrong relationships. That negative person that's draining all your energy. That drone. Get out of the wrong relationship without being rude. Remember, we don't get rid of people and we're rude. God blessed Lot. But Abraham had to move on into the land that God had for him. We have to move on, CRC. We have to imagine a new South Africa, CRC. We can't imagine the past and go back to an old South Africa. We can't go back to hurt and anger of yesterday. God says, look forward. Come out of the ceiling of your hurt. Come out of the ceiling of your inferiority. Come out of the ceiling of your low self-esteem. Come out of the ceiling of your own shame and your own guilt and condemnation. Come out of the tent, is what God says, and lift your eyes. Stand before the cross. Stand before Jesus and lift your eyes and see the land that God has for you. you and dream God's vision for your life. Come on, shout yeah or something. Just look alive tonight. Be a dreamer in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
If this powerful message has touched your life and you'd like to give your life to Jesus, pray the following prayer with Pastor Art.
Pray this prayer with all your heart in Jesus' name. Say, Lord Jesus, I give you my life. I give you my heart. Thank you that you love me so much that you died for my sin. I believe with all my heart you rose from the grave. I believe you are alive. I open my heart tonight and I invite you to be my Lord and Savior. Thank you for forgiveness. Thank you for a new beginning. Thank you for acceptance. Thank you that you love me just as I am. Remove every sin, every condemnation. Let your Holy Spirit come and fill my life. I give myself to you. I surrender all. In Jesus' name.
Those who wait upon the Lord shall mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and they will not faint. Come on, have you not heard? Those who wait upon the Lord.
Thank you, Pastor Art, for that incredible message. Our annual Dream Week conference starts on the 4th of October, this coming Tuesday, hosted by Pastor Art and Pastor Noreta Bosov.
Yes, one conference in two cities. It will be hosted both in Bloemfontein and Pretoria. For more information, please visit our website at crc.org.za. That's all we have for today. I'm Angelique De Brain.
And I'm Sidi Gude. God bless.